This hybrid inverter has a hidden feature that could save you hundreds of pounds, and many installers are unaware of its existence. Even if they are, they often struggle to configure it properly. So that's what we'll be doing in this video. But let's start by revisiting how a solar inverter operates. A conventional inverter converts DC power from solar panels into AC power to run household appliances or feed excess generated power back to the grid. Since most individuals are often away during the day and unable to use the power, it's typically exported to the grid at less than favorable prices. A hybrid inverter adds battery storage, allowing the surplus energy generated by the solar panels to be stored. This stored energy can then be used within the home at the owner's convenience or exported to the grid during peak electricity pricing to maximize earnings. Also, hybrid inverters can recharge the battery from the grid during periods of low electricity prices, so homeowners avoid buying energy at high prices. While everything sounds promising, it's important to note that there are regulatory restrictions on how much energy can be exported back to the grid. There are also financial and practical constraints on battery storage capacity in a hybrid inverter. Consequently, during the peak summer solar generation period, there are instances where surplus energy from larger installations has basically nowhere to go. The batteries are at full capacity, all home appliances are being powered, and the grid's export limit has been reached. This surplus energy is then wasted as it dissipates as heat within the solar modules. Now, at this point, it feels reminiscent from a scene from The Great Escape, searching for ways to dump excess energy. And one popular method involves repurposing the hot water cylinder into thermal storage battery by leveraging surplus electricity to heat the water using an immersion heater. However, a solar energy diverter is required for this setup to function effectively. These devices measure the surplus energy exported from the property and instead redirect it to the immersion heater. For instance, if there's 1 kilowatt of energy being exported to the grid, the diverter shifts this energy to the water tank through the immersion heater. Acting a bit like a dimmer, the diverter adjusts the power output to align exactly with the generated surplus energy. Now, solar energy converters can cost up to £500 excluding installation, which could take a long time to pay back compared to gas water heating, based on a typical home using around 4 kilowatts of energy for hot water per day. And here's the secret. This SunSynk hybrid inverter has a built-in function at no extra cost that eliminates the need for an energy diverter. Although labeled as an auxiliary load, its capabilities go beyond just handling loads. You could utilize the terminals for inputs from microinverters, wind turbines, or even diesel generators. Yes, I did just say diesel generator. If you know why this could be useful, share your experience in the comment section. Due to the flexibility, the auxiliary output is also sometimes referred to as a generator input within the instructions for the inverter or on the circuit board. So things can get a little bit confusing. However, it works slightly differently from an energy diverter by using a defined amount of power from the batteries when they are full. Let me explain. A sign that an installation is producing excess power is when the batteries are 100% full. So at this point, we set the auxiliary output to switch on. The immersion heater will then draw its full rated power from the battery. To avoid using all of our stored energy, we can limit the battery power available for water heating by switching the auxiliary output off when the battery level falls below 90%. The auxiliary won't switch back on until the batteries charge back up to 100%. So in this way, we're modulating the power to the immersion heater using a small amount of battery capacity. To avoid using battery capacity when the panels aren't generating, you can also set a solar threshold so the output won't switch on unless there's at least some power being generated. This is useful at night if you want to charge batteries from low-cost grid energy and not then divert that energy straight away to the water heater. Because the auxiliary output maintains the full rated power of the immersion heater, existing electronic controls and time switches can be left in circuit, which is not the case with solar diverter fed units. This opens up the option to feed other electric heating loads such as underfloor heating or storage heaters with built-in controls. The settings for the auxiliary load can be accessed via the inverter touchscreen or the SunSynk Connect app. You can also force the auxiliary output on if you're in desperate need of hot water and it hasn't been a sunny day. Several factors need to be considered in the electrical layout. The cable and circuit supplying the inverter must be capable of handling the inverter load and the load connected to the auxiliary output. For example, 3.6 kilowatts for the inverter and an additional 3 kilowatts for the load. So this would necessitate a 32 amp circuit. In the SunSynk datasheet, you can see a maximum specification for pass-through current, which for the 3.6 kilowatt hybrid inverter is 35 amps. The cable from the inverter to the immersion heater will likely have a smaller cross-sectional area than the cable feeding the inverter, so therefore would require its own protection, such as an MCB or a fused connection unit in the UK. While a circuit supplying the inverter is typically safeguarded by an MCB, the cable to an existing immersion heater may require additional protection from an RCD, which could be further integrated within the fused connection unit. When setting up new builds, connecting to the immersion heater is a simple process, yet modifying the wiring and including extra circuit protection might pose a challenge for existing installations. However, in the video that's currently on screen, we've discovered a clever workaround that enables nearly any circuit to be powered by the auxiliary load with just a few straightforward wiring adjustments.